Morning dear students, welcome back to our lesson and biology class, and we were looking for the lesson life processes. And in my last class I explained you about the two or three important components of the alimentary canal. Those were mouth, then pharynx and the oesophagus. And in today's session we are going to have a closer look, or we are going to study in detail about two remaining important parts of the alimentary canal, that is stomach and the small intestine. We will have in detail what it is called. Okay, see student, we have seen that from the oesophagus the food will now enter. Where the food will enter now? Into the stomach. What is stomach actually? The stomach is a J-shaped organ, and which is exactly, if we will talk about my stomach, then it is at the left side of the body. Okay, it is at the left side of the body. It's the most wider part of the alimentary canal. Its shape is like a J, and its wall, or the wall of it, is made up of the epithelial cells. Students, the wall of the stomach are made up of the epithelial cell. It is J shaped. It's the most wider part of the digest, or the of the alimentary canal. Okay, and it has a folds on it. It has a folds on it. So whenever the food is trying to enter from the oesophagus into the stomach, it directly do not drop down the food, the bolus. The bolus do not directly drop down into the stomach. There are specific muscles. Okay, those muscles are called what? Sphincter muscles, which regulate the entry of the food material, which regulate the entry of the food material. So anyhow, from the oesophagus the food do not drop down into the stomach. The food slowly with the help of the continuous contraction and relaxation, I said you, that is called as what? Peristaltic movement. So very slowly the food, when the muscles, the sphincter muscles are getting relaxed, that time the food is trying to enter into the stomach. Okay, so if you will talk about the structure of the stomach, and then the structure of the stomach is like this something. Okay, this is the structure of the stomach. Okay, and here those sphincter muscles are present here. Exactly, this is the part of the oesophagus. From oesophagus, the whenever the food will enter the bolus, okay, churn the food, which is actually we have broke down the food. Mechanical breaking down of the food has taken place along with the salivary glands. That food will enter into the stomach, but directly it will not drop down. It will have specific muscles. Those muscles will get relaxed and the food will enter into the stomach. Stomach is what? It's a J-shaped organ. It's the most wider part of the alimentary canal. It is a pouch or a bag-like structure. It has a various folds on it. Its membrane, its inside structure of it, is made up of the epithelial cells. Understood? And to the inner lining of the stomach contains mucus glands. Mucus gland secretes mucus. Digestive gastric glands are present. Okay, gastric glands are present, that in that mucus is also coming. Okay, mucus glands is also present, that secreting the mucus, and gastric glands which secretes HCl and pepsin. We will talk a later. So if we will talk about the stomach, it's the muscles are present. It is also muscular, like oesophagus. It is also muscular, but these muscles are elastic in nature. It has a folds on it. So at a time, 1 to 1.5 kg of food we can eat. At a time, we can eat, and that much food can remain into our stomach. Okay, and it's a bag, like a traveling bag. Traveling bag, you are knowing students. So traveling bags, various pouches are there. When we open that completely, it becomes big. So stomach is also like a traveling bag only. It has a folds on it. So whenever we try to fill it, it can swell up. So after having our meal, any meal, our stomach little comes in forward direction. This is because of this reason, that it is elastic in nature, and it's a elastic muscular wall, and it's a like a bag pouch, masculine pouch, which is elastic in nature. Okay, so 1 to 1.5 kg of food can occupy into the stomach. If we will talk about the parts of the stomach, then the stomach has three parts. This part is called as what? Fundus. This part of the stomach is called as fundus. The middle one part is called as a body or cardiac also it is called. Cardiac. This card is cardiac because it is near to the heart. I said you, it's at the left side of the body. It's near to the heart, so it is called as a cardiac or it is also called as a body. The end part of it is called as a what? Pyloric. Pyloric. So our stomach will have a three parts. First is fundus, second is body or cardiac, and third part is called as a pyloric. And I said you, the wall of the intestine, the wall of this stomach is made up of epithelial cells. Epithelial cells means what? That I have explained you last year, epithelial tissue. You can go back and see last year's book, textbook, and you will be able to understand epithelials. Epithelial cells are present into the inner wall of the stomach. Okay, and this stomach wall is secreting some gastric juices. Various glands are present, students. If you will opt for the biology in class 11, you will be able to understand the physiology. In that, everything you are able to learn which glands are exactly present. Now, it's not suitable to tell you everything because it won't be possible for you to grasp everything. You will be confused. So, here I would like to know you that there are various glands are present. Those are called as a gastric. The word is related to the gastric. If the word is renal, then it is related to the excretory system. If the word is cardiac, then it is related to the heart. If the word is gastro, then it is related to our stomach. Okay. So, various gastric glands are present. Mucus glands are also present. So, what these gastric glands are secreting? Actually, the three major things are secreted by the gastric glands. I hope you understand the structure of stomach. So, I would like to go ahead to explain you what exactly is secreted to the gastric glands of the stomach. What is secreted through the gastric gland? Stomach, if you will see, gastric glands, if you will see, then HCl is secreted. Okay, the second thing is secreted, that is mucus, and the third thing secreted, that is pepsin. Okay, now we'll see in detail HCl. What it does? It does not allow the foreign particle. It protects the food which is entering. Actually, now in our salivary glands, in our saliva, lysosomes are also present. And those lysosomes, what they are doing, any foreign particle, any microorganism, if it would come in our food, in the bolus, if it would come, that microorganism is getting killed because of the lysosome. But then too, if any foreign particle would enter any microorganism, any pathogen, I would say, more pathogen would be more correct because pathogens are the microorganisms who are harmful. If any pathogen would come and would try to enter into the stomach, then stomach will have a HCl of 1 pH. pH you will learn in your second lesson, that is acid, bases and salts. In that you will learn. So pH means what? The potency of hydrogen, means the concentrated hydrochloric acid is secreted by the gastric glands. Okay, hydrochloric acid of 1 pH, which is really very concentrated. It's not possible to touch. Okay, so that HCl, which is more concentrated, which will not allow to enter any foreign particle or any pathogen into the stomach. So, it will help us to protect. Okay, it will help us to protect. Actually, lysosomes are present. I said you, in lysosomes, there are able to digest the foreign particles and the pathogens. But then too, by mistake, if any pathogen would enter into the stomach, then HCl, in front of the HCl, it would not survive, it would die. Okay, so HCl is performing the role of it. Okay, as well as it facilitates or it enhances the activity of the pepsin. It facilitates, first I said you the protection, then the second I am saying you, that is the facilitates the action of the enhances or facilitates the action of Pepsi. Means what, student? If HCl would secrete in a proper amount, then only it will allow to activate to the pepsin to work. If HCl would not work properly, then pepsin will also unable to work properly. So keep in mind, it enhances the activity of the pepsin. If HCl would be secreted in more amount, then only pepsin would start working. If you will talk about the second thing which comes into the gastric juice, which is secreted by the mucus glands. The mucus glands are present, and these mucus glands are secreted mucus. What is the function of the mucus? As I have drawn here the structure of the stomach, I said you the inner wall of the stomach is the lining, or the inner wall of the stomach is made up of mucus. Why it is so? As I said you, very concentrated HCl is secreted into the stomach, and it may be harmful, it may be injurious to the wall of the stomach. So to avoid it, the mucus layer is present, which protects the inner wall or the lining of the stomach. Okay, so mucus is also playing an important role. But sometimes what happens, student, because of the hyperacidity, the mucus is also having a small hole, and the stomach is also having a small hole, and that is called as what, peptic ulcer. Okay, in my previous video I explained you about the peptic ulcer. Mouth ulcer you are quite knowing about it, but it is called as a gastric or the peptic ulcer, means which is causing a very small wound to the stomach. Okay, but that can be avoided by the gastric gland, such as mucus gland, which secretes the mucus. Now if you will talk about the pepsin is called as what? The protein digestive enzyme. Proteins are converted into amino acids by the action of pepsin, but here complete digestion of the pepsin is not taking place. Means if it is a large molecule of the protein, then it will convert into the small molecule of the protein. Complete digestion of the protein will not take place here by the action of the pepsin. Why it is not taking place? Because I said you, partial digestion is taking place into the stomach. Complete digestion is not taking place into the stomach. Partial digestion of the food is taking place into the stomach. Okay, not complete digestion. Complete digestion is taking place into the small intestine. Okay, into the first part of the small intestine. So proteins are getting converted into small proteins, not completely into the amino acids. And in infants, if we will talk about, the renin hormone is secreted. Renin hormone is less powerful than the pepsin. Renin enzyme is less powerful than the pepsin. Because we eat a high amount of protein, and to digest that high amount of protein we need pepsin. But infants are not using much amount of the protein. Okay, very less amount of proteins are used by them. So less active renin hormone is sufficient for them to digest the protein. So renin hormone is secreted into the infants to digest the protein. And once the child is getting mature, then the place of the renin is taken by the pepsin. One more thing is secreted by the gastric glands, that is called as what? That is called as lipase. And this lipase is responsible for the lipids to convert into fatty acids. But here also important thing is that the complete digestion of the lipids is not taking place because of the lipase. The reason is same. The complete site of the digestion is what? Small intestine, not a stomach. Here the partial digestion of the food is taking place. So here also there would be the large molecules that will convert into the small molecules. The complete digestion of the protein and of the lipid will not take place into the stomach. Partial digestion of the food, as well as storage of the food and mechanical and the chemical breaking down of the food, is taking place into the stomach. So I hope you understand what are the gastric glands and what these are secreted. First they are secreted HCl, then mucus, then protein digesting enzyme, that is pepsin, renin and the lipase. And all together is called as what?
gastric juices. And when this gastric juices are mixing into the food or the bolus which has entered from the oesophagus, is all together is called what? Chyme. It is called what? Chyme. Okay? And the churning process is taking place over here. Churning of food is taking place. That only I said you, mechanical breaking down of the food. Chemical breaking down of the food is obviously taking place because all these chemicals are mixing into the food. So mechanical breaking down as well as chemical breaking down of the food is taking place into the stomach, but not completely. Okay, so I hope you understand about. We move ahead to the small intestine. Small intestine is mainly designed into three parts. That is what? Duodenum. Duodenum. The second part is jejunum. And the third part is ileum. Okay. Now, complete site of the digestion, since long that I am saying, that is taking place into the duodenum and into the jejunum and the ileum, the absorption of nutrient is taking place. I hope you understand. This duodenum is about 25 centimeter long. We have a two intestine. We have a small intestine and we have a large intestine. Here students, you might be knowing that small intestine is actually its lumen is very small. Lumen means what? Its width is very small. So that it is called as a small intestine. Otherwise, small intestine is too long. As compared to other parts of the alimentary canal, small intestine is too long and it is into the coiled form. It is kept into the gastric or this gap. Okay, in the gastric column into the stomach, it is properly kept because it is into the coiled form. But actually, it's a too long. So in your NCERT book, it is asked why herbivores have a large small intestine. Means why small intestine is too big for the herbivores. This is the reason, because herbivores are eating what? Green leafy vegetables or green leaves they are directly eating, which contains most amount of cellulose. Okay, and so that cellulose digesting enzyme is less secreted into the herbivores and it takes a long time to digest because less secretion of the cellulose digesting enzyme, as well as it takes a long time to digest because the enzymes are secreted in a less amount. But into the carnivores, they are eating directly raw flesh and all, and they have a specific kind of enzymes to digest that food. So carnivores will have a small intestine, but the herbivores will have a large small intestine. This is the reason, okay, because they are eating cellulose rich food and cellulose digesting enzymes are secreting lesser in their small intestine. So it takes a time to digest it. Okay, so the things you keep in mind. So duodenum, if you will talk about the large and the small intestine, this is of about 6 to 9 meter complete. If you will talk about the large and the small intestine, it will be of 6 to 9 meter. Okay, both are of, and it's a tightly compactly kept into the stomach. Properly it is kept. Okay, into that compartment, it is kept into the coiled form. Okay, so duodenum, if we will talk now from the food has entered into the stomach. Okay, here it is called as a chyme. From the chyme, the food will enter into the duodenum. But here also, the food will not directly enter into the duodenum. It will have a specific muscles. Those muscles are called as what? Sphincter muscles. The sphincter muscles will get relaxed and slowly food will enter into the duodenum. Okay, and duodenum is the complete site of the digestion. This duodenum is what? The complete site of digestion. Why it is called as a complete site of digestion? Because students, I said you, whenever the chyme would enter into the duodenum, it will have some juices, intestinal juices. Duodenum will have some intestinal juices. That intestinal juices will mix. Intestinal juices will mix into where? Chyme. okay, as well as what will mix in it. The food has entered into the duodenum. At the same time, there is at the right side of the body, we have a liver, okay, and liver will secrete what? Bile juices. And that bile juices, which temporarily accumulate or will get stored into the gallbladder and into the liver, these are into the, we can say it is into the hypotonic form, or we can say these are less diluted, but diluted form. But when it will enter into the gallbladder, it will be more concentrated. Okay, so it can act on the lipids more properly. So from the liver, the bile pigments will secrete and it will accumulate into the, gallbladder. And from the gallbladder and from the liver, the bile pigments would secrete, and that bile pigments are responsible for the digestion of the lipids to fatty acids, or emulsification of the fats will take place here. Okay, emulsification means large globules of the fats will get converted into the smaller globules of the fats. Okay, that will be taken place by what? The liver and the gallbladder, which secretes the bile pigments. Okay, so bile pigments will be there. As well as we will have, and liver is, I said you, which is the largest gland into the body. This liver is actually 1 to 1.5 kg. 1 to 1.5 kg liver is present. Okay, its mass of the liver is 1 to 1.5 kg. Beside it, there is the second most largest gland in our body, that is called as what? Pancreas. This pancreas is working like an endocrine and exocrine system, I said you. When this pancreas will secrete pancreatic juices, which will have a trypsin, okay, which will have a trypsin, and this trypsin, what it trypsin would do? This trypsin will be enhancing the digestion of the protein. Okay, we have a protein. Protein is already digested little amount. Okay, that protein will get completely digested into amino acid by the action of the trypsin, which is secreted by the pancreatic juices. Understood? I hope this term is clear for you. Okay, so trypsin will get secreted by the pancreas. Pancreas will secrete pancreatic juices. Pancreatic juices will have a trypsin, which will be able to digest the protein. Okay, here complete digestion of the protein will be taking place. Okay, so lipids and the proteins will get digested over here. Okay, so now this all, everything, intestinal juices, then bile pigments, our food, everything will get digested here in the duodenum. Okay, and into the duodenum, it will enter into the next part of the small intestine, that is called as what? Jejunum. Okay, this is the complete site of the digestion. Here, that complete everything, intestinal juices, chyme, bile pigments, and our trypsin will get converted, means protein, lipids, everything will get digested. Carbohydrate is already digested into the glucose. That everything will get converted into the water soluble form. The nutrients will get formed, which will be water soluble, and that water soluble nutrients will enter where? Into the jejunum. That water soluble nutrients will enter into the next, the further part of the small intestine is called as what? Jejunum. And if you will see, I shall rub this and I shall explain you the part of the jejunum. If you will see jejunum, then the wall of the jejunum will have a such longitudinal linings or finger-like projection will be present inside the wall of the small intestine, or the inside the wall of the jejunum. That is called as what? Finger-like projection is called as what? This is called what? Blood vessels. Blood vessels will be arranged into this finger-like projection. That is called as what? Villi. This is called as what? Villi. Okay. Why the structure is arranged like this? Why the structure is longitudinal? These are what? Blood vessels. Okay. And blood vessels are designed over here to absorb the nutrients, water soluble nutrients, which are made by the duodenum. Okay. And this will get absorbed. If it will be a single line, or if it will be in a straight line. Okay. If this blood vessel will be in a straight line, then what would happen? It will occupy very less area. In very less amount of nutrient, it will be able to absorb.
okay, the complete absorption will not be taken place. So to increase the surface area for the absorption of the nutrients prepared by the duodenum, we will have this finger like projection called as a villi. Okay, so here the absorption of the nutrient will be taking place. Okay, now the food will enter after jejunum. The food will enter where? Into the ileum. The food will enter into the ileum, which is the last part of the small intestine. It will also have a specific shape, student. If you will see the wall, inner wall of the, or the inner lumen, if you will talk about of the ileum, it will have like this structure. How this structure is looking like? This structure is looking like a funnel. Is it looking like a funnel? The inner wall of the ileum will have this funnel like shape. Okay, it will have a funnel like shape, or it is also called as a mushroom shape or the club shape. Okay, club shape or the mushroom shape. Why it is like this? Because in the jejunum, most of the nutrients are absorbed, water soluble nutrients are absorbed by the jejunum, but still some nutrients are present. Okay, and as I said you, this is the site of the absorption. Okay, into the small intestine, the complete site of the digestion is what? Duodenum. But the complete site of the absorption is what? Jejunum and the ileum. Still some particles, some nutrients are remain to absorb. So those nutrients will get absorbed into the last part of the small intestine, that is called as what? Ileum. The surface is like that. So most of the nutrients can enter into it and will get absorbed by the wall of the small intestine. And in this manner, the complete digestion and the absorption of the nutrients or water soluble food will be taking place into the small intestine. I hope you understand all the points or all the parts of the small intestine as well as the stomach too. So I think it's clear for you. In further classes, we'll go for the large intestine. Thank you very much.